Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled, The Role of the Church in the Community. This is lesson number 5 in that series entitled, Jesus on Community Outreach. It's the lesson for July 30 of 2016. I think you're going to find it very interesting. I hope you have your Bible handy because we're going to be doing a lot of looking at the Bible. But right now I'd ask you to join us and let's have a word of prayer to begin. Our kind and wonderful Father, what a privilege it is to meet together with friends and talk about your word. And when we look at your example, as we will do today, and realize the challenges that it presents to us, may we be humbled, but may we be ready to follow in your footsteps is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Have you ever thought of Jesus and community outreach? What would that mean? What was Jesus' community?
Everywhere around him. When he's waking time, he mixed with everybody.
He's been doing that since before anybody was created.
Yeah.
To try to bring everybody into harmony with himself.
Okay. So you're going to say he's got a community of the universe.
Yep.
Okay, but in terms of his human community, that's what we're trying to talk about now. He grew up in Nazareth. What do we know about Galilee and Nazareth?
Is there anything good that can come out of Nazareth?
Yes, that's a direct quote from Scripture, isn't it? Yeah, Nazareth is located about 2 miles from Sepphoris, which was a Roman colony there to try to make sure they would keep down any uprisings that might arise in Galilee. And I mean, Jesus probably spent a lot of time working over there. Those would be the people who had money that you could make carpenter things for. I just don't know. I'm just speculating, but I'm thinking that's very possible.
I was kind of wondering, what's the opposite of community? Is there another, what's the flip side to it?
The flip side would be a hermit.
Yeah.
No. Someone who's out there by himself and doesn't want to have anything to do with anybody else.
Or
there's some prophets like that, wasn't there?
Well, a little bit. Yes, so, Diane, you got it.
Or people who just wall themselves off and they don't allow other people in. They're exclusive as opposed to inclusive.
Okay. Gordon, were you going to comment? Or more or less the same?
Same thing.
Okay, there's a very interesting little tidbit, little story at the beginning of our lesson I'd like to read with you. Robert Louis Stevenson, best known for his adventure story, Treasure Island, had been a sickly boy who couldn't go to school regularly. Finally, his parents hired a teacher to educate him and a nanny to help with his personal needs, so obviously they were not suffering financially, were they? One night when his nanny came to check on him, before he went to bed, he was out of bed and his hands and nose were pressed against the window. His nanny firmly told him to get back in bed before he got a chill. Robert asked her to come to the window and see what he was seeing. The nanny came to see. Down below on the street, there was a lamplighter lighting the streetlights. "Look there," Robert said. "There's a man poking holes in the darkness." I thought that was a great story. So, of course, you might ask, well, what does that have to do with us? You remember Matthew 5:14? What does it say there?
We're to be the light of the world.
Yeah, we're to be the light of the world, aren't we?
Light on the hill.
Matthew 5:14, you are like light for the whole world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden.
So we got to all go out and poke holes in the dark.
That would be wonderful, wouldn't it? How can we do that? Obviously, it's not like walking down the street with a torch.
We need to find dark counties to do that.
Well, that would be one place.
Right here.
I don't think we need to go too far.
I remember as a child, Adventists didn't mix too much with people around the place. With ourselves, yes. Some did, but it was more or less the minister's job or the co-porter's job. We've changed some, but sometimes I think not enough.
Yeah.
How do you square that with in Old Testament times? It seemed that Israel was told to kind of keep to themselves. They weren't to intermingle, certainly intermarriage, it just seemed like there's lots of passages in the Old Testament, certainly the writings of Moses specifically, that, you know, you're a peculiar people, don't...
Well, if you go back and you look at those passages, as I have done with one of my classes recently, you'll find out there's just one reason why God told him to do that, and he keeps repeating it. He says, don't worship any of their gods. Don't leave any of their idols standing. Don't just get rid of their temples. Don't worship their gods. That's the whole point.
That doesn't seem very ecumenical to me. It seems rather...
You think we...
What is the term we use for that these days? Genocidal or something like that?
What would you do if somebody came in and started throwing your Bibles away?
Well, I mean, obviously wouldn't like it.
Wouldn't like it. Well, isn't there kind of a similarity there?
Well, the question is this. And this is one of the major problems in our world today. From a political standpoint, the government feels like they have to treat all religions as if they were of equal value. They're not.
Thank you.
You mean the governments don't, or the religions aren't?
Their religions are not equal.
And I don't think the government actually treats them equal. There is priority given to every type of religion but Christianity.
Yeah. Because they feel, I mean, the reason they feel that Christianity has had all the priorities in the past, so now they're going to right things by fixing it.
The thing was, where Israel settled, they were in the crossroads of the then-known world.
Yep.
They had it set up if they'd have behaved themselves.
They really were chosen by God, though, to win the world to God's way of life.
Well, we came here to discuss Jesus' community. Here's a start. Look at Luke 4. This is Luke now. We were in Matthew 4. This is Luke 4, verses 14 and 15. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, and the power of the Holy Spirit was with him. The news about him spread throughout all that territory. He taught in the synagogues and was praised by everyone. Okay? Now, by contrast to that, look what happens next. Then Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath he went as usual to the synagogue. He stood up to read the scriptures, and now we need to break down this story into a little bit of steps so we can see it. So what's happening here? What's the setting we just read about?
It's where he was raised.
Yeah. What else does it say about him?
He usually went to the synagogue on Sabbath.
Yes. What else?
They handed him the scrolls. He obviously could read it. He had some education.
But backing up a little bit, we're talking about community. He has now reached out to all kinds of different groups in Galilee, and they all think he's great, right?
Yes.
All before he comes home.
Until he comes home.
That's right.
Now we're going to focus on what happens when he comes home. When he got home, people were surprised and attracted by the fact that his teaching was not like the teaching they were so familiar with from the authorities and the scribes. And you know this passage in Matthew 7, 28 and 29. When he was finished speaking, what he meant was clear. When the authorities spoke, they were usually vague or ambiguous in their teachings. Well, when he came back to Nazareth, they handed him the scroll, as we mentioned, and he read from Isaiah 61, 1 and 2. And I'm going to read it from Isaiah now instead of reading it from from Luke. The sovereign Lord has filled me with his spirit. He has chosen me and sent me to bring good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to announce release to captives and freedom to those in prison. He has sent me to proclaim that the time has come when the Lord will save his people. And he stopped right there. And what comes next?
And defeat their enemies.
And defeat their enemies. What was their most favorite part of that whole passage?
The last
defeat
phrase.
Defeating
their enemies, exactly. Why do you suppose Jesus left that out?
Because he knew it would stir up trouble. Which it did later on.
Well, what sense would it stir up trouble?
He didn't want to enhance their beliefs that that's why the Messiah was coming.
He didn't want to support their false ideas about what the Messiah was going to do.
And how appropriate is that? is to read a passage about what the Messiah is going to do and then ignore part of it.
Yeah, don't some people in other churches do that? We get after them for doing that?
Okay.
So Jesus does it, and it's okay.
You suppose that last portion was put in there by a scribe? It wasn't meant to be there?
That's a good answer. That's probably it. You're right.
There's a text to support that, and that would be Jeremiah 8:8, and it says, the scribes have made it into a lie.
Mm-hmm. Well,
or that last phrase referring to the third coming.
Yes. Well, here's from Ellen White. She's going to spell this out a little bit. During his childhood and youth, Jesus had worshipped among his brethren in the synagogue at Nazareth. In other places, she actually says, because he had such a beautiful voice, they often asked him to read the scriptures, even as a young boy. Since the opening of his ministry now, he had been absent from them, but they had not been ignorant of what had befallen him. As he again appeared among them, their interest and expectation were excited to the highest pitch. Here were the familiar forms and faces of those whom he had known from infancy. Here was his mother, his brothers and sisters. And a lot of people said, brothers and sisters, who are they? Well, we know that he had at least four brothers, and he had at least two sisters, maybe more, and they were children of his father and not children of his mother, obviously. Here were his mother, brothers, and sisters. All the eyes were turned upon him as he entered the synagogue upon the Sabbath day, and he took his place among the worshipers. In the regular service for the day, notice this very carefully, in the regular service for the day, the elder read from the prophets and exhorted the people still to hope for the coming one who would bring in a glorious reign and banish all oppression. He sought to encourage his hearers by rehearsing the evidence that the Messiah's coming was near. He described the glory of his advent, keeping prominent the thought that he would appear at the head of armies to deliver Israel. Does this give you a clue about why he left out that part? When a rabbi was present at the synagogue, he was expected, yeah.
I have a question. Is that paragraph describing what happened every week or just that one week?
It's describing what happened that particular week, but it was a very common occurrence. That was their blessed hope. That's the kind of stuff they wanted to read every week. So when a rabbi was present at the synagogue, he was expected to deliver the sermon, and any Israelite might give the reading from the prophets. Upon this Sabbath, Jesus was requested to take part in the service. He stood up to read, and there was delivered unto him a roll of the prophet Isaiah. Now, this is important for some reasons that I'm going to suggest right now. What language was Isaiah written in?
Hebrew.
What was the mother tongue of Jesus?
Aramaic.
What kind of language would he have to speak if he was doing work for the Romans?
Latin.
Maybe, or Greek. Latin or Greek. So there's very good evidence, I believe, from this passage that Jesus spoke at least three and maybe four languages. He didn't come from America.
Well, we're only bilingual.
Yeah, right. Well, we know what happened. We have, where have we heard these words before? Actually, maybe we should read them. Luke 4, 16 to 19. Then Jesus went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up on the Sabbath and so forth. He did read up to 19. Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. All the people in the synagogue had their eyes fixed on him. As he said to them, this passage of Scripture has come true today as you heard it being read. What does that suggest?
He is the Messiah. Well, he didn't come straight out and say, well, I'm here, I'm the Messiah, but that was what he was angling at. Didn't take them too long to figure it out.
Jesus stood before the people as a living expositor, these are words from Ellen White again, of the prophecies concerning himself. Explaining the words he had read, he spoke of the Messiah as reliever of the oppressed, a liberator of captives, a healer of the afflicted, restoring sight to the blind, and revealing to the world the light of truth. His impressive manner and the wonderful import of his words thrilled the hearers with a power they had never felt before. The tide of divine influence broke every barrier down. Like Moses, they beheld the invisible. As their hearts were moved upon by the Holy Spirit, they responded with fervent amens and praises to the Lord. It's a wonderful service, right? But when Jesus announced, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears," they were suddenly recalled to think of themselves and of the claims of him who had been addressing them. They, Israelites, children of Abraham, had been represented as in bondage. They had been addressed as prisoners to be delivered from the power of evil, as in darkness and needing the light of truth. Their pride was offended and their fears were roused. The words of Jesus indicated that his work for them was to be altogether different from what they desired. Their deeds might be investigated too closely. Notwithstanding their exactness in outward ceremonies, they shrank from inspection by those clear, searching eyes. "Who is this Jesus?" they questioned. He who had claimed for himself the glory of the Messiah was the son of a carpenter and had worked at his trade with his father Joseph. They knew all about him, didn't they? They had seen him toiling up and down the hills. They were acquainted with his brothers and sisters and knew his life and labors. They had seen him develop from childhood to youth and from youth to manhood. Although his life had been spotless, they couldn't point out any errors in his life. They would not believe that he was the promised one. What a contrast between his teaching in regard to the new kingdom and that which they had heard from their elder. Jesus had said nothing of delivering them from the Romans. They had heard of his miracles, had hoped that his power would be exercised for their advantage, but they had seen no indication of such purpose. As they opened the door to doubt, their hearts became so much the harder for having been momentarily softened. Satan was determined that blind eyes should not that day be opened, nor souls bound in slavery be set at liberty. With intense energy, he worked to fasten them in unbelief. They made no account of the sign already given when they had been stirred by the conviction that it was their Redeemer who addressed them. Desire of Ages 237 to 238. That was a fairly lengthy passage, but what does that tell us? Remember, we're talking about the community in which Jesus grew up and lived.
I think it's pretty common that people don't want to think bad things about themselves. They didn't want to be the ones that were poor. They didn't want to be the ones that were blind and had all of this. They wanted to think that they were already on top and he was just going to raise it up another notch.
Yep.
You know, I wouldn't blame them if they listened to Jesus and they said, you know, "Say what? What are you saying?" You know, type of thing. But where they went overboard is when they started getting angry and started wanting to do him in. I mean, at that point, that's where, you know, the line should have been drawn in anybody's mind.
Yeah.
Because just being polite to somebody, you know, that has got crazy ideas, you should be able to do that. But I'm not saying he had crazy ideas, but if this was coming up, you know, like for the first time, and you needed some time to think about it, well then.
So what was his major problem as far as they were concerned?
Well, he was certainly wasn't a king.
He wasn't
just a carpenter's boy.
Yeah. He's not the kind of Messiah we're waiting for. Who are you? Who do you think you're? A Messiah? You're the kid from down the street who used to make our benches and our tables.
So where did they get this notion?
They were hearing it every Sabbath from their elders.
How come some story made up? There are no scriptural passages for that.
Oh yeah,
he's going to come as a king. And
I mean, look at their heroes: David, Solomon. Yeah. You know, all those people, they were all kings. Moses wasn't just a street urchin either.
No.
So what do you expect? Yeah.
There were promises that it would come, do things like King David did and so forth.
Yeah.
So it's hard to blame them, it seems to me, that they had this misperception.
Yeah.
I kind of think there was probably a few that stirred it up, and then they got all their emotions going.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you'd see it. Well, you know who's behind that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But
seems to me some of those Pharisees, some of those Pharisees hadn't been studying their own scriptures, because they tended to get things mixed up here and there and put in what they wanted to see. They all loathed the Romans.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's an easy tendency for
yes,
everyone in every generation.
In that last paragraph that you read from mm-hmm. Desire of Ages, it almost sounds like the devil is actually able to insert thoughts into people's minds.
Have you ever been tempted?
I've been tempted. I do it to myself.
I see.
Does Satan actually insert thoughts?
You
think it's thoughts, or is it emotions that he's injecting in, and the thoughts come as a reaction of the emotions?
Satan was determined that blind eyes should not that day be opened. It sounds like he non-verbally convinced them.
Yeah.
I don't think it was convinced. You're being too brainy about it. I think it's an emotional thing that's happening.
The Bible says we were made a little lower than the angels, which tells you the other way around. When you think about it, they're a higher form of life. They've been around a lot longer than we have. We don't know really what they can do, but I think they're talented.
Not wanting to be ethnically prejudiced or something, but to be truthful, when we see on the news reports of things that go on in the Middle East, and we find these people out in the streets, it doesn't seem like it's just very easy for that culture to go out in the street and start jumping up and down.
It's almost as bad as what they do in Los Angeles, huh?
Well,
and then some.
But, Ken, I've mentioned this before in here. You read this passage, even when we read it today, and it looks like it's a very literal thing, but it's very spiritual, mm-hmm. And so forth. So how do I know things of my own faith when I think about the coming Messiah mm-hmm. and descriptions and passages, and when he comes, it's going to be this way and that way and this way? Well, how do I know I'm not making the same mistake, that it's not going to be maybe as literal as what we think? It's really going to be just as spiritual as this. How do I know I'm not making that same mistake?
Well, there are several safeguards in the Bible that we're recommended. One is keep studying the Bible. This is where the truth is spelled out to the best of our ability, spelled out by at least 40 different authors over 1,500 years, and we need to keep reading that. Furthermore, the next step is, when we think we have a new idea about what the Scripture says, we need to compare it, we need to try it out on our friends. And if they say you are out on a limb way out where, then probably better back off a little bit. And it says, compare your ideas.
Well, isn't that what they were doing when Jesus was telling them these ideas, and then they started, this guy's going crazy. Well, it's the very same thing that you just said, only maybe not as over the top, but yes, it's still the same direction.
But were they studying their scripture? What they were doing is they were going to church, they were listening to what their leader said, and they were swallowing it hook, line, and sinker.
Well, how many
they were not studying for themselves.
Scripture. I thought maybe the rabbis had to read it to them.
Well,
so yes, they're going to have to wait until a rabbi is ready to read.
These are challenges.
Yeah.
Let's try another story. The story of the Good Samaritan. A very, very familiar story to Bible-believing and reading Christians. What do you know about the details of that story?
Two of the people that were listening to him actually were involved in it.
Well, the expert in the law understood that all the commandments, remember, this young man came, the Pharisees put him up to it. They were hoping that Jesus wouldn't know that they wouldn't recognize who he was, and it looked like he was just a fresh young man who was asking an innocent question. And what was their plan? What was the idea here?
The usual thing, they're out to trap Christ.
Yes. Okay. Well, let's see if we can figure out how that all went down. So he's asking a question, and Jesus turns the question back on him, and he answers the question. So he looks kind of dumb. Why do you ask a question when you already know the answer, right? So then what happened? So he said to Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" God in his providence, now I'm reading from Desire of Ages, page 500, paragraph 1. God in his providence had brought the priest and the Levite along the road where the wounded sufferer lay, that they might see his need of mercy and help. All heaven watched. Who was watching?
Heaven.
All heaven watched to see if the hearts of these men would be touched with pity for human woe. All of heaven was watching as the priest walked right on by, and the Levite looked and walked right on by. The whole universe was watching. We do not need to tell anyone who's familiar with the scriptures how the Jews felt about the Samaritans and vice versa. Look at just a couple of verses. Look at John 4, verse 9. It's a different story, but the woman answered, "You're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan, so how can you ask me for a drink? Jews will not use the same cups or bowls as Samaritans use." I mean, you know, what do we have to do with you, right?
So you're saying that that situation was predictable. So if they're saying I'm not a Jew, you're a Jew, and I'm somebody else, and why are you even doing this?
The guy that was wounded was a Jew, and the two people who walked past him were Jews.
Yes, okay? That's right. Okay. Absolutely right.
So I'm just trying to help us to understand what's going to happen next. Yes.
Ellen White, I hadn't really realized before that Ellen White suggests that those two men were sent by to help this guy on the road. It wasn't just a coincidence that they were there. They were sent to help him.
Yes.
To rescue
these are my words. I'm just trying to help us think more clearly about what Ellen White said. While the whole universe was watching, the priest and the Levite came upon the wounded man. All those men could think about was themselves. We should not worry about all the surveillance cameras that are being installed, because we already know the whole universe is watching us, as it was on the road from Jericho that day. Well, here's the shocker. This was no imaginary scene, but an actual occurrence, which was known to be exactly as represented. The priest and the Levite who had passed by on the other side were in the company that listened to Christ's words. Desire of Ages 499, paragraph 1. Now, do you think Jesus looked at them and said,
I don't think he needed to.
I don't think he did.
I don't think he did. They, I'm sure they were ready to hide behind a bush or something, you know.
Do you think if they knew that they were being watched, that they would have done something then?
Probably.
Yeah, I think so too.
Because their whole lives were for appearances.
But it could have been the Jewish tax collector too. I mean, there's all kinds
of
things.
Oh dear me!
So why did
If
he's Jewish, why did they pass by and not lend some help?
Well, I'm going to read what might they ask themselves: what might happen to me if I stop and help this man? Because I could be contaminated.
That's right.
And I'm on my way to Jerusalem.
You mean because he's sick or something? Or they might pick up some germs?
Maybe he's sick. Maybe he's whatever. Yeah.
Maybe he's dead.
Maybe he'll get blood on them.
If he's dead and you touch him, then you're contaminated for the next week. I'm on my way to the temple to work in Jerusalem.
Well, if he looks dead, well, then why would they even have any real reason to stop?
Well, did they stop long enough to figure out whether or not he was dead?
Well,
walking on the other side of the road.
What was he? No, wasn't he beat up?
He was beat up really bad.
Well, you know, that's the story of that road, the Jericho Road. Yeah. There were thieves and robbers who hid out, and as you went down, there was a very common experience. So how did they know it wasn't some kind of a ruse? I mean, they may have thought, you know, if I go over there and help this guy, he may be pretending, and then all of his buddies jump out and beat me up, and so this is not a smart thing to do.
No. Well, and that's exactly. So these two guys, when they walked by, says, what could happen to me if I stop and help this man? The Samaritan now asked, what might happen to this man if I do not help him?
Yes.
The outlook was totally different.
What's the difference between these two?
Well, but what happens if the story goes on as we've described it?
Yeah.
And then it was a ruse, the story goes on, and the Samaritan got beat up and killed and or paralyzed, and his family went without food because he couldn't make it, and you know, and all of those terrible things. So
we're looking at this as an example of Jesus, okay? He's telling the story. Now I'm going to ask you a question since you raised that one. If you have a neighbor living next door to you that's not a Christian, and you have a reasonable suspicion that if nobody says anything to him, he's going to be lost, and you could say something to him that would help him to be saved, what's your responsibility?
Well, I've got next door Adventists that I think are that way.
Then you better say something.
Let's bring it down to prison. What about those two soldiers and that other man that nailed that terrorist on a train? That's the difference. They jump right in, and that's what this guy did.
Well, yeah, but you know, when you ask them, you know, the press thinks you're really a hero, they'll say, I'm not a hero.
He might have said the same. He went to the innkeeper and left some cash. Look after him. I'll pay you when I come back if you need more.
Yeah. Well, in the story of the Good Samaritan, I'm reading now from Desire of Ages again, page 497. In the story of the Good Samaritan, Christ illustrates the nature of true religion.
Was the Good Samaritan there too in this group?
I don't know. Probably not, because he was a Samaritan and this was Jewish worship. Okay? He shows that it consists not in systems, creeds, or rites, but in the performance of loving deeds and bringing the greatest good to others in genuine goodness. I'll give you a real example. We have someone living not too far from us, working on the campus here, several people, who put themselves in absolute danger by fighting the Ebola outbreak that happened in West Africa recently. Mm-hmm. Was that a Good Samaritan or a thing, or was that a walk by the priest thing?
I think it's a Good Samaritan, because no matter how you rig up, you can still catch it sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Do you really think that they were decided to do that because they wanted to do something good? Or did they just do it because that's the way they were?
Exactly. That's the problem. Yeah. That's the problem. The lesson is no less needed, Ellen White goes on to say, in the world today than when it fell from the lips of Jesus. Selfishness and cold formality have well nigh extinguished the fire of love and dispelled the graces that should make fragrant the character. Many who profess his name have lost sight of the fact that Christians are to represent Christ. Unless there is practical self-sacrifice for the good of others in the family circle, in the neighborhood, in the church, and wherever we may be, then whatever our profession, we are not Christians. Wow.
Now, when you read that, are you saying I should behave better? Or are you reading that and say that Christ needs to be in us more?
Behaving better sounds like a good idea, but Christ in us sounds like a better idea.
Well that's true, but as you read this, it sounds like, boy, I just haven't done this right, you know, type of thing. When you really should be thinking, you should be coming to Christ to get that spirit inside you so you could be that way.
Think of Matthew 25, the separation of the sheep and goats at the end, you know.
Right.
You know, the judgment, the final judgment. Who, you know, when did we help you, Jesus? Mm-hmm. When you helped the poor, when you helped the needy, when you helped the Samaritan, the man on the road.
So it was just a reaction.
We need to be filled with the love of Jesus.
We
need to be filled with the love of Jesus and manifest this love to everyone around us.
And
we cannot, of course, do it without Jesus living in our hearts.
Right.
Love is a precious gift we receive from Jesus, so we cannot do it alone.
Yeah, but you know, when you were reading that, I was just looking, oh, woe is me, I'm just not doing it good enough, you know, type of thing.
Yeah, well.
When you really should be saying, what you're breeding there is a person that doesn't have Jesus in them.
Right.
You know, type of thing. So.
Diane.
I really like this example a lot because the man that was beaten up and you know, bloody, possibly unconscious by the side of the road, didn't look good. And when we work on outreach projects, the people that we're meeting up with, the people that we're talking to, they don't look so good.
Mm-hmm.
They're dirty, they're smelly sometimes. Down at the station, we're fortunate enough that somebody comes by and about once a month, every other month, we'll do haircuts, free haircuts. And the difference that makes in some of these men is just pretty remarkable.
Yeah.
Maybe they didn't look, you know, we have just one level that we're looking at right now on this story. And, you know, I didn't want to get dirty, I wasn't going to help, all of this kind of thing. The people that need us the most don't always look good, don't
yep.
always smell good.
Yeah. And some of them, unfortunately, if you try to be nice to them, I have patients who are like, wow, here's somebody that's nice. Let me spend the whole afternoon talking to them, you know? Well, to the Jews of Jesus' day, it was very clear that a neighbor would have to be a Jew, and probably a Jew of his own social class. For Jesus to suggest that a neighbor could be a Samaritan or even someone more foreign to them seemed incredible. Well, how do you think you would have felt if you had been the Levite or the priest as Jesus told that story?
Do you think they actually got it? They were very deeply enculturated in this whole thing about this is the way I am and this is what I do, and God has said, you know, don't get involved with these people, you know, keep yourself separate. They really hadn't come far enough along that they could really reach out. So should they have? Of course. But that would have been a huge leap.
And the question for us in 2016 here is our church ever going to move beyond
the comfort,
whatever you call our condition right now? Will we ever do this kind of stuff?
Laodicea, I think it's called.
Yeah.
It seems to me, it parallels what Christ did when they were brought the woman taken in adultery. He just got down and started writing in the sand, and they all slunk off. I think these two gentlemen did the same.
Probably.
Well, what do you mean, will a church ever come to this place? What do you mean by the church? We have Diane, who is a good example of the work that she's doing down here at the corner with a group of people.
Yeah.
They feed, 50 people every day or something like that? And right next to them, there is a thrift shop where people donate to their goods, and people can come in there and get things very cheap. We have even the smallest of Adventist churches, there's often one or two ladies that are doing the Dorcas thing down there. So, and we've got ADRA, an official denominational thing that we even give church budgets to. Our school up here, like not just our school, but all schools, we take mission trips to different places, different countries, even when we had the problems of the floods.
So why hasn't Jesus come back then if we're doing everything we're supposed to?
Well, maybe there's more to it than just this.
Let's be honest here. We've run missionaries almost since inception of our mm-hmm. church.
Yeah.
But we don't often get down in the gutter with drunks.
Mm-hmm.
And we're turning it around, but we haven't been too good with all that.
So we got to go down as low as we can.
The bottom line is they're still God's people.
Now, Carrie, I've heard you tell some stories about some of the work you do with people who are severely mentally handicapped, and I don't recall you kind of talking about keeping your distance there.
No, I can tell you stories about other stuff we've handled which's not appropriate for this program.
Yeah. Well, what the story is really telling us is that our neighbor, everyone out there who is the most needy, we need to reach out to them. And Ellen White puts it in these words, no distinction on account of nationality, race, or caste is recognized by God. He is the maker of all mankind. all men are of one family by creation, and all are one through redemption. Christ came to demolish every wall of partition, to throw open every compartment of the temple, that every soul may have free access to God. His love is so broad, so deep, so full, that it penetrates everywhere. Christ taught the lessons 386.
So now we started out with that passage in Isaiah, which talks about this very thing.
Mm-hmm.
But is that, did Jesus do that when he was here?
Yes.
I don't know. There sure were a lot of turmoil and sickness and other things when he went back. And
he was out there touching, you know, being friendly to people who were demon-possessed.
Well, I know that.
One of his favorite followers had been, he had to cast seven demons out of it at seven different times.
But when even he was here doing those kinds of things, the end of the world didn't come.
It wasn't time for the end of the world yet. The end of his world came.
Well, now we've wandered off into another Sabbath school lesson.
Yes. Another quarter.
So how many Adventist churches are near people and places where help is needed?
Not many.
Where I don't know how in the world you can say that we've reached there. It seems like no matter how deep we reach and get into the mud and the dirt and the stuff, you can always go farther in. And
that's
if
fine.
The Lord doesn't come again, you say you're not doing it enough. So you keep going in.
That's
so
wonderful.
Where do you stop and say,
you don't
okay,
stop.
We've made it.
No.
Well,
no,
that's
no.
My point. There is no point. There, there is a point that when the Lord decides that's it. And it's the Lord's decision. It's not what we're going to be doing.
Okay.
But we keep going.
We just keep going. That's true.
Here's a thought. Okay. Here's a thought. The poor we will always have with us.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe what's happening is more on the inside of us when we're doing the outreach than what happens to that person. We're down at the station. We have some people that will probably all show up for the breakfasts, have no desire to make any kind of change, but some do. And those are the ones that, you know, that you're reaching out for. In the meantime, what's going on inside of me when I am putting out the energy to do some of the things that we do to outreach to them? Mm-hmm. Maybe I need this as much as they do.
Yeah.
Talking about your mud, Gary, let's talk about your mud. One of the examples that Jesus uses was salt. So when you pour salt into your food, what happens to it? It obviously stays aloof from everything else in the bowl, right?
What?
It stays aloof from everything else in the bowl that you're mixing?
Well, it doesn't turn into mud.
It depends on how much you put in and what you're using.
Exactly.
Well, the salt just makes things taste better.
But
it only preserves things,
yeah,
too. If you take all the salt away, everything would rot.
And you'd be left with mud.
That's right.
But if you put too much salt in it, it's bad.
It makes your heart pressure go up.
Your blood pressure goes up, yes. Yeah.
You know, it's very interesting. If salt were a brand new medicine that some pharmaceutical company was trying to introduce, it would never be allowed. It's way too dangerous.
The FDA wouldn't go for it.
The FDA would ban it right off.
It's like because you can overdose?
Lots of things. Yeah, you can overdose.
Oh.
But a lot of food would be near tasteless if we didn't have salt. So that's why we as Christians need to get out there and mix with the world. Well, unfortunately, many Christians have grown up with the idea that there are insiders and outsiders. Now, of course, I don't know what that means. What is insiders and what does insiders and outsiders mean?
Let's be honest, we all know.
When I was in my 20s, I think the phrases we were using were our people and not our people.
Yes.
Right.
But then it ends up really being very tribal.
Yeah. So now here's the challenge, and Gary put it very well, so let's go with him. How do we get out there into the mud without getting muddy?
That's the problem.
Well, it seems to me if we really love Jesus and we are very close to him every day, mm-hmm. I don't see how we can really go for the idols of Babylon, you know? Mm-hmm. If you really have a close relationship with Jesus, we should be able to mingle with people without any problem of actually going astray.
Mm-hmm. We don't have any idols today, do we? I haven't seen any Baals around or...
You haven't watched people walking around like this?
Yeah.
Exactly. Worshiping, right?
Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Well, let's pick another story. The story of Jesus with the Samaritan woman, found in John 4. Now, we don't have time to read the whole story. We're running out of time already. But the story is fairly familiar. Jesus and his disciples have been walking probably half the day in a hot sun. They come into this little valley. There's a nice well there with some really nice water. I can attest to this because years ago I had the privilege of going to that valley and drinking some of that water. Great water. But the well is deep. It's deep, no question about it. So Jesus is coming there. He doesn't have a rope. He doesn't have a bucket. And his disciples say, "Will you rest here and we'll rush to town and see if we can buy something to eat." And what happens? Along comes a woman. A woman of what country? What place?
Samaritan
woman. Oh, dear. Was Jesus supposed to have anything to do with Samaritan women?
No.
Not at all. In fact, she recognized it right up front, didn't she?
Yes.
And it's very interesting. Jesus didn't just jump right in and try to tell her, "You're a sinful woman," all that kind of stuff. He started by asking her to help him. Would that be a good approach sometimes to deal with people who are out there in the community?
Very good approach.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Is that better than offering your own help to them?
Depends on what the situation is. Sometimes you don't have the option of offering them help because they need help. But sometimes you can say, "Well, can I have a drink of water? Can I have something simple?" And you get their attention. And, "Oh, yeah, sure." Well, you know the conversation that went on, and Jesus ended up by saying what to her? What were his final, near final words?
"Go and sin no more."
"I see you're a prophet, sir." The woman said, "My Samaritan ancestors worship God on this mountain, but you Jews say that Jerusalem is the place where we should worship God." And Jesus said to her, "Believe me, woman, the time will come when people will not worship the Father either on this mountain or in Jerusalem." And then he went down even further, and the woman said to him, "I know that the Messiah will come, and when he comes, he will tell us everything." And Jesus answered, "I am he. I who am talking with you." And I tried to imagine, you know, did her eyes go... You know?
I bet she was figuring it out.
Yeah?
Well, I wonder what other clues there are besides Jesus just saying, "I am he."
Well,
because anybody could do that.
Well, there were some other clues. Like, you know, that's not your husband you're living with. You had five others. How did you figure that out?
A running travelogue.
Yeah, exactly. Well, and who knows how many other... How many other things he said to her about her past? We just have a very brief version of this story.
Well, it'd help if there was a little more, because then we could learn a little bit about not getting shammed.
Well, the disciples came back, and what did they discover?
They were surprised to see what was going on.
Yeah. Did any of them say, "Why are you talking to her? What do you want?" No. And the woman left her water jar, went back to the town and said to the people there, "Come and see the man who told me everything I have ever done. Could he be the Messiah?" So they left the town and went to Jesus. Now, I've puzzled on this, and I would like to know your opinion here. I puzzled on this in my own mind. Did the townspeople know about her background? And so now here's somebody who's a stranger and all of a sudden expounding to her background, and they say, "Wow, how did he know all that stuff?" Or did the townspeople not know about her background, and they said, What's going on with her? What do you think?
I personally think they knew everything that she did. There's probably all kinds of rumors going around, and some true, some maybe not be true, and stories of men, what
but
men
if she
have
came
told
back
tells.
Into town, if everybody knew, she's talking about this Messiah, why would you believe her?
Well, I would think if I was her, I don't know for sure, but I would be a little bit embarrassed about all that stuff. And if she come in there and say, come meet the man that told me everything I ever did, well, that would make my make a question mark come up in my head real fast.
As I've heard people talk about this story before, it's often mentioned that this is an unusual time for her to come after
yes.
water.
Yes.
And the reason, one of the reasons she was probably there was
to avoid
privacy.
The local
that's right. To yeah. avoid all the stuff that's going to go on when all the rest of the women were there.
Yeah.
But she stirred the pot up pretty well, because we know later, much later, Christ came through there, and that a lot of that town came out
she
to listen.
She became a great evangelist.
Yep.
Exactly.
It's very interesting that Jesus goes to one side of the country, casts demons out of two men, and they become great evangelists. Now he goes to Samaria. He speaks for a few minutes with a woman. She says, becomes a great evangelist. And
maybe,
so what's going on with us?
We need to go down in those on Sunset Strip in the evenings and in L.A. and chat with some of those ladies down there. Maybe we could make a lot of converts down there.
Mount Vernon, you know, and San Bernardino. Yeah. You don't have to go that far.
It's right here. There are people that do that as we speak. There was an article in one of the weekend papers of a lady who was taken into that at the age of 14, and now she's turned around and trying to save them. So yeah. What's going on?
I mean, you could go down to Sunset if you want to, but I think there's a lot of people who are in need and not nearly that far away.
It's right here.
You know, well, you're talking about, you know, Jesus just talked a few words to her. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to put the situation in there, too.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
She probably you know. Cleaned up her act quite a whole lot. Certainly gave her a jolt.
Well, okay, our lesson goes on to talk about farmers. Now, I don't know if any of you have been farmers. I grew up in a farming community. So at the end of the year, at the end of the harvest year, and you go out and you harvest a field, that's great, that's wonderful, that's payoff time, right? But what happens if you haven't done any preparation, you haven't prepared the soil, you haven't planted the right seed, what happens?
No harvest.
You're not going to get any harvest.
Go hungry.
So what might that teach us about spreading the gospel?
We should constantly be cultivating the soil and sowing the seed, and there should be the
being
evangelistic cycle, as we call it, you know?
So I'd like to see that plan.
Cultivate the soil, sow the seed.
Okay, what would be some good examples about how to do that?
We're told to love our neighbors as ourselves, and there's often neighbors, immediate neighbors, that need help.
Mm-hmm.
It's a question.
Well, one thing I would think is to be consistent in your life.
Yeah.
Okay.
That would be one. Maybe tell the truth all the time, as much as you can, without. Sometimes you don't.
Yeah.
Give ourselves to God for the saving of the lost and take advantage of every opportunity. And it's nice to get involved in clubs and things like that. My wife has been doing that in library in our city. And she went in and started a knitting program. And it's brought people to the Lord. She cultivates the soil. I mean, you know, they really get to know each other. They love each other. And then those people begin to come to our church programs. And I have one right now that's asking me, please get back to baptize me.
Yeah, okay.
And she came from that library.
Mm-hmm. It has been demonstrated again and again, I don't think this should be news to anybody, that the most successful baptisms, the people who come in, they become a part of the church, they stay, are the ones who are loved into the church again and again and again by someone they know who sort of brings them. Very few people who just have one or two exposures to Adventism come into the church and stay in the church. We're big on evangelistic campaigns, and I you know, I'm not knocking them, but unless there's been a lot of soil preparation and all that kind of stuff in advance, and the people, maybe the pastor comes and he actually baptizes somebody, but if they haven't been prepared by you and me beforehand, it's not going to be all that successful.
And then as soon as they're baptized, we ought to continue to study with them for at least a year and get them involved in teaching others. That's when they're involved in teaching others that they really become strong.
And that's where we lose so many because we don't.
Right.
We're running out of time, but in Matthew 10, verses 5 to 10, Jesus sends his disciples out, not talking about witnessing, he sends his disciples out into Galilee without any food, without any extra clothes, whatever. He just says, go and let the communities out there support you. Is that a good idea?
Not these days.
Wasn't it part of the culture back then to a degree? I mean,
well, some, maybe more so than now, but
even certainly in the patriarchal age, when you came in as a visitor into a town, it was my understanding, it was kind of customary for people to, if you were a stranger, to bring them into your home so that you didn't have to sleep out at night. And
there's a story told, and I'm going to have to use up the last few seconds of our time. A story told about a pastor who was asked by his church to go to an area where there was all kinds of problems. See what you can do. And what did he do? He went there and he started talking to the local people. He would park his car nearby, would talk to them. He'd talk to the business people. He'd talk to other people. He joined some business clubs, etc. What do you think happened?
He found out their needs.
Mm-hmm.
And they accepted him.
Mm-hmm. And pretty soon, they're asking him questions about himself and so forth. Now there's several thriving churches in the place where that experience took place. Could we do those kinds of things?
That's a move.
Some areas, yes. Mm-hmm. Farming communities, you probably could. Mm-hmm. Some of the big inner cities, you might want to be careful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I know.
Well, be careful, let's not be prejudiced here.
Jericho Road there.
Well, in the Great Judgment Day, we already know, we've talked about Matthew 25. God says, if you didn't do it to him, do it to the least of my children, you didn't do it to me. Our kind and loving Father, what a privilege it is to worship you, to try to imagine to the best we're capable in our day, so far from the time when you were here on this earth, what it must have been like for you to walk the dusty streets, the dusty roads of Galilee and Palestine and Judea so long ago, and find ways in which you could befriend people and reach out to them and touch them and heal them in so many ways. Help us to find ways in which we can do those same kinds of things in 2016 and beyond is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.